But we begin this morning with the writer C.S. Lewis, born in Belfast in 1898, famous as a novelist and poet, and especially as a children's writer, who died just 50 years ago, on Friday last. His death went comparatively unnoticed, because he died on the same day that John Fitzgerald Kennedy was assassinated.
That's true, and it was slightly eclipsed.
His biographer, A.N. Wilson, talking to Andy O'Mahony.
But since, there have been the most extraordinary growths, both in America and in Europe, of interest in Lewis on lots of levels. Literary interest, primarily interest in him as the author of the children's stories, interest in him as a religious figure. And now, as you mentioned, this play Shadowlands, I mean, he's almost a figure of mythology in himself, because Shadowlands doesn't bear any relation to the actual facts of the case, what it was like when he got married to Joy Gresham.
But does it strike you as emotionally or imaginatively true, if you like?
It's a very good play. Mm. Probably as true as anything. I mean, you go back to the conversation Tolkien and Lewis had, what is truth? You only can perceive it through mythology.
Yeah. From Rattlebag's archives, Professor Terry Dolan of UCD summarised C.S. Lewis in these terms.
C.S. Lewis was Irish. He was born in Belfast, and he went to England to be educated. He went finally to Oxford, where he did a series of exams, became Fellow of Magdalen College, as Richard Murphy just mentioned, and then he began a marvellous career as an academic and also as a great writer of children's stories, and he wrote fluently and wonderfully and imaginatively until his death in 1963. So he died just before his 65th birthday, and he was enormously influential both as a writer of children's stories and also as a writer of great academic works, including one called The Allegory of Love, which he wrote when he was quite young in 1936, which is still the standard work on the whole idea of allegory and love in the Middle Ages. It's a very important work because so much of his later writing was allegory. And so he wrote, first of all, about the theory of allegory, then he wrote the Narnia stories, the Screwtape Letters and other books, which show the integrity of his whole intellectual life as a great writer, an imaginative writer as well. He wrote extraordinarily well and very, very powerfully. He became the object of cults in America and elsewhere, and so, to answer your question again, he is a major factor in the academic and literary and imaginative world of the 20th century.
Over 20 years ago, A.N. Wilson published an acclaimed biography of C.S. Lewis. Andy O'Mahony talked to him about his research for that book.
Well, I would say it was the most important fact about him, really, yes.
He's referring here to the death of his mother when C.S. Lewis was still a young boy in Belfast.
We don't know very much about the mother. She's rather a shadowy figure. But clearly, when she died, something was sealed off in Lewis and he never recovered from it. He never grieved. He never went through the proper process of being able to howl and scream when he was a little boy. He was packed off straight away to an English boarding school, which is a terrible thing to do to a child.
And you would say that, in a sense, he was trying to come to terms with it all his life?
I should have said so, yes. Mm. In his writings, in his dealings with other people, everything.
And then, to complicate matters, he had would appear to have had an ambivalent attitude to the father.
Well, I suppose that was all part of it, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. That the father was absolutely shattered by the death of his wife. It happened, as it sometimes does happen in families, that it wasn't just one death. The father lost his brother at the same time. And he was distraught and beside himself. And couldn't give these little boys, C.S. Lewis and his brother Warney, what they needed at that time. And I think probably, without quite realising it, Lewis associated this awful pain of losing his mother with a feeling of alienation from his father, something like that.
You went back to Belfast to have a look at
the
homestead and that, yeah. What struck you above all there?
I think, in some ways, it's bigness. It's a great, big, comfortable house in Strand Town, which is just in the sort of comfortable middle-class suburb of Belfast, with a lovely view over the loch and over the docks. And one realised what an extremely prosperous world it was.
His father was a solicitor, right?
Yeah. Edwardian, late Victorian Belfast. His father was a police court solicitor. He was a very charming, funny man by all accounts, and you can see, reading Albert Lewis's, that's the father's account of himself, that he, if we'd met him, we'd have liked him, but if he'd been our father, it might have been a different story. He wanted to be loved by these boys. He wanted to be friends with them. he bored them very considerably. That was one of the tragedies.
But what was the thinking behind the son, later to be called Jack, coming to England at all?
It was something that Protestants, particularly in the North, did. They were sort of ambivalent in their attitude to Ireland and Irish education. And also they were a bit snobbish. I mean, they wanted to improve themselves. And Albert Lewis asked his old headmaster in Ireland, what should I do with the boys? And he said, well, send them to an English prep school. They sent these children to a school they'd never seen, miles away from home.
Yeah, there was a succession of schools, wasn't there?
There was a succession of terrible schools. Mm. But a lot of people I've spoken to who had that kind of upbringing in the north of Ireland had exactly the same, that they were packed off to school in England.
He hated England at first. I mean, was that something that remained with him? I take it he got to like it a bit more.
Well, obviously, he liked the landscape of England. I mean, even when he went to school in Malvern, which was one of the unhappiest periods of his childhood or adolescence, he loved the Malvern Hills, and he always went there for walking holidays in grown-up life. Yes, as you say, when he got off the boat in Liverpool and he heard these English voices speaking, I suppose, roughly as I'm speaking now, he conceived a hatred for them. He loathed the sound of the English voice, even though, of course, because he was educated here, he came to speak with an English voice himself. And I think there was a very deep part of himself that never lost that. His closest intimates, if you think about it, they were never English. And he always felt a bit of an alien, I think.
Very precocious boy, essay on Wagner at 13.
Extraordinarily precocious. That essay on Wagner could have been written by somebody, you know, doing a criticism for the radio aged 25 or 35.
Just astonishingly gifted, so therefore stood out from the beginning.
He stood out, and obviously if you are a very clever person and you're nursing a great grief, I think probably you throw yourself more into the intellectual work than he would otherwise, and he lost himself in books and found his great happiness in books. Always.
Besides his fame as a writer, Lewis established himself as a literary critic, an academic, medievalist, and a lay theologian. But it was as a professor of English literature at Magdalen College, Oxford, that Irish poet Richard Murphy first met him, as he told Miles Duncan in this RTE Radio public interview.
The scholarship exam I went in for was had five colleges, and Magdalen College was one of them at Oxford. And I chose Magdalen as my first choice because C.S. Lewis was the tutor there. And my tutor at Wellington had studied under Lewis, and Lewis was the great guy. He was as near to God as a man could get on earth, and he wrote these wonderful books that... if I read them at all, I tried to believe that every word was true, and I tried to adjust my mind to this conviction, even if I didn't hold it. I think I ought to quote this rather than try and remember, because the Luftwaffe had spared Oxford. I followed directions through a maze of high walls, quads, cloisters and stairs to a small dark room hundreds of years old, where an older boy was sitting on the edge of a table, flicking through pages of notes, a lock of thin yellow hair hanging over one eye, with a Midlands grammar school accent and a stammer painful to hear and watch. He said, I've lost hope. Why? I asked. I wrote too little in the exam. How much did you write? Never more than 40 pages. A glance at his notes showed a script no larger than mine, 12 pages, my maximum. Called to judgment, I sleepwalked on a wobbly floor in a dream of being examined orally at Oxford to the centre of a room full of middle-aged and elderly dons, and heard a purring voice say, Mr. Lewis would like to ask you a question. All eyes turned to the bright, jovial face of a short, plump man who was sitting on a sofa smoking a pipe. His head reminded me of Shakespeare's in the church at Stratford-upon-Avon last summer. Can you tell me, Mr. Murphy, he began as the sofa started to rise off the floor, what is meant by the divine right of kings, and what importance, if any, is given to belief in that right by characters in Shakespeare's Richard II? While I was answering with fluency beyond my control, quoting passages learnt by heart, the sofa turned upside down in midair, with the balding top of C.S. Lewis's head a foot above the floor till the end of my answer. I was told to keep an eye on the notice board in the Porter's Lodge, where the results would be posted under the heading of demyships. On my third scanning of notices, I found a typewritten sheet that announced the awarding of demyships in this order to Tynan, Kenneth Peacock, Murphy, RWL.
Good company.
At the gateway to paradise, Lewis had let me scrape through.
The Protestants in America who like him so much don't like the fact that he smoked 60 cigarettes a day and dropped slightly blotto every night of his life.
Final words on C.S. Lewis from his biographer, A.N. Wilson.
It wasn't seriously alcoholic, but he liked to drink. Mm-hmm. And obviously, if you're a teetotaling, non-smoking Baptist in Oregon or somewhere, and you revere the works of C.S. Lewis, you like to cut out all the references to smoking and drinking. Similarly, there are other people who don't like the fact that Lewis had a sexual nature, and the doctrine of the perpetual virginity of C.S. Lewis enjoys vogue in some circles. Against all evidence, of course, but then religious beliefs don't require evidence.
And that row will go on between the two camps, claiming him and seeing him in different ways.
I think so. Mm-hmm. There's a huge stained glass window of C.S. Lewis in California. People have seen C.S. Lewis risen from the dead. I mean, he's a he's all set to be a great mythological character.
A.N. Wilson, Richard Murphy, and Terry Dolan on C.S. Lewis, who died just 50 years